joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sound. Joyful sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves, our God saves. Sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves, our God saves. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. You rule the world with truth and grace. You rule the world with truth and grace.
God and sinners reconciled, joyful all ye. join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn. Glory to the King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time behold Him come, offspring of the Virgin's womb. The Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn. Glory to the King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all He brings. Risen with He. Mild He lays His glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Glory to the King. Glory to the King. Glory to the King.
So good to have each one of you here this morning. We have two or three things we'd like to bring to your attention before we get into our study of the Word of the Lord. The first is, immediately following the service today, our mission department has prepared lunch for us. It's on a donation basis. All of the proceeds will go to help our mission trip for this coming summer. And so you're invited to stay and fellowship and have a great lunch together. Also, I wanted to remind you that our Advent devotional books, they're still in the foyer. There's a few that are left. If you did not pick one up, please feel free to do so. And those are free to you. And just study right along with us during this Advent season. And then one last thing is... each year, we as a church, we look at ways that we can reach out and help others during this time of the year. The Lord blesses us all during the year in so many ways. And in the past, we have adopted families, we've adopted pastors, we've adopted churches and ministries and on and on. And I'm always amazed at the faithfulness of our people in giving. This year, we started back in July, believe it or not, asking for funds to give to smaller churches who are having difficult times paying their pastors and supporting their pastor families. And so this year at Christmas time, you notice we don't have a specific tree in the foyer designated for gift cards for you to buy. But would you set aside a little extra funds? And over the next few weeks, as the offering, well, I started to say as the plates are passed, we haven't done that in a while, as our ushers are at the back door at the end of the service, why don't you put some extra in there? Just mark it Christmas special or helping others or however how you want to. And we'll do this up until the Sunday before Christmas. We want to make sure that we are able to present these funds and these things to the churches that are in need. So can you join with me in doing that? Yeah, I know you will. Well, our Advent focus this year, as you heard last Sunday, is on the sounds of Christmas. Now, when I came up with that idea back months ago, I thought, well, when we talk about sounds of Christmas, it's going to create a lot of different thoughts in people's minds. You're going to think about your favorite Christmas carols. You're going to think about bell ringing. You're going to think about the laughter and the excitement that you hear in the voices of our children. But last week, we started out this study kind of in an unusual way, because our sound of Christmas was that of silence. And I know we think, well, silence isn't a sound. Well, it is deafening at times because, well, it creates these thoughts that go through our minds. And when our minds get in gear, sometimes we allow it to take us to some dangerous places. It took us into the Old Testament last week, into the book of Malachi chapter 4. Now, that's a book of the Bible and a chapter of the Bible that we don't really spend a whole lot of time studying. But yet I pointed out to you that that passage of Scripture brought to us came from the very last book of the Old Testament and the last verses of the Old Testament. And the reason that we called it the Sounds of Silence was because that book, when it ended, basically ended the Old Testament, but started what, well, theologians and scholars and historians have called down through the years the silent period. In other words, those final words of Malachi were the last words recorded in our scriptures until the coming of the New Testament. A 400-year period when, well, no books of our Bible were written, no words of prophets were recorded, and it doesn't mean that there was no movement of God or that God had just gone on sabbatical or something. Instead, it was God had seen through the centuries that His people just weren't going to listen to Him. And so, as we would say, why waste your breath? But you think about it, 400 years without hearing words of encouragement or words of guidance from the Lord. Is it any wonder that so many people on the earth during that day actually lost all of their hope in God? It was as if God can't hear us anymore or God's not listening anymore, and so we're done for. But can I tell you that during that period of time, there were individuals that still held on to the hope of the Lord. They held on to a prophecy that had been spoken years before that talked of a coming Messiah, one who would come in the form of a child. But yet, you heard the scriptures that were read during our Advent moment would be the one, the Savior of the world. These individuals held on, and it was this hope that they had that brought them the assurance God still cared. Now, can I ask you something? Do you ever face times in your life where you say, I just need some assurance that God, you really care? The world may come against us. The world may seem as though it's falling in on top of us. We need assurance from God. Now, when we speak of the word assurance, that word, like so many other in our English language, can have more than one meaning depending on how it's used. And so, I just wanted to give you an example. For instance, When we talk about assurance, it can be a positive declaration. It can be a promise that provides us with hope. I could stand up here and give you assurance this morning that all is well. And we would take that and it would give us hope, hopefully. Or it can mean a certainty of mind or a freedom from doubt. We can say that I have an assurance, or, you know, there's life insurance companies that will sell you assurance plans. In other words, trying to give you peace of mind with a promise. Well, I don't think we can begin to fathom the feelings of neglect and the feelings of doubt that those individuals went through during those periods of silence. But let me tell you something. There were those who held on. There were those who gained that assurance. So this morning, what I want us to do is I want us to focus on today's sound of Christmas. And that sound is going to be the sound of assurance. We're going to leave behind the Old Testament where we left off last week, and we're going to take up in the New Testament. We're going to look at the beginning in the book of Matthew to where we begin to see God giving assurance to His people, and how when He gives that assurance, it comes in the form of the fulfillment of the prophecy of the one who was to come. The prophecy that those people had held on to for so many years is going to be fulfilled. And the one who is going to bring it to pass is going to come in the form of a child, just like it was prophesied. And His advent or His coming will make a way for all mankind to be set free from sin and uncertainty like that which abounded during those silent years. Let me read our text for you today. It comes from Matthew chapter 1, and it begins in verse 18. Listen to this. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. I want you to think of that. He puts together a plan, a game plan of what he's going to do in order to move forward. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are going to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophets. "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife, but he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. In that passage of Scripture, we see what I like to call a progression. You know, we start up here, and there are different steps that take place, and finally, by the time that progression is done, we find ourselves way up here. There are some things that take place each step of the way that can help us better understand what was happening in this passage and even better understand the plan that God had put into place. Hopefully, what we're going to see today will help some of you, well, develop an assurance in your life that God still loves you, God cares for you, God has a plan for your life. It may be different than the plan that you have in mind, but God's not going to give up on you. So what I want to do is try to help unravel this mystery of the progression here. And I want to begin with this. Step number one. It's going to sound a little negative because it is doubt. Doubt. Now, that's not a very good place to start, is it? If we're going to talk about positive things and talk about Christmas and Advent, we ought to start with something joyful, right? But let's look at that term doubt. Doubt, you know, are feelings of uncertainty. Doubt seems to be woven into our DNA. It just seems to be a common emotion, right? We hear people all the time say, well, someone said this, but I really doubt it. Or I thought something was going to happen, but I doubt if it's ever going to come to pass. Now, doubt comes in many, many forms. One of the most deadly forms is what we call skepticism. I hate to admit it this morning, but you know what? Years of being in ministry, I find at times it makes me a skeptic, and I don't like it. A lot of times it comes to pass when we get numerous individuals that come to the church during the week with needs. And to me, it's like, how do we decide which need is legitimate, which need is not? What do we do? How can we help? And you know, there are times when I hear someone pouring out their heart and I'm thinking, okay, is this real? Are you telling me the truth? Or are you just trying to scam me? Skepticism really and truly comes to pass in the form of, well, it makes us question truth. It makes us question validity of things. Our text begins this morning with the introduction of two people. We know those people well, don't we? Mary and Joseph. Man, don't they play a huge part in the Christmas story? Now, we look at Mary an awful lot longer and more than we do at Joseph, but yet Joseph is the central figure in our lesson for today. He and Mary, as we just read, were engaged to be married, but as the New Living Translation puts it, she had become pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, needless to say, Joseph's emotion, Joseph's feelings, backed up here by Scripture, skepticism. Joseph had his doubts. Joseph didn't know whether to believe what he was being told as truth or not. And it gives us a great example of how doubt works on all of us. When we begin to have our doubts, now see if this sounds familiar. When life causes us to have doubts, in the midst of those doubts, we start to worry about our life. When we start worrying about our life, it's not just how am I going to get through this, how am I going to succeed, how am I going to carry on, but you pour in on top of those doubts things like, well, what are other people going to think of me? What are they going to say? Are they going to like me? Are they going to reject me? And all of these doubts, when they begin to pile up on us in these ways, we tend to make plans. Those plans oftentimes are, well, we're headed this way, but my dreams want to take me over. So we're going to turn and we're going to try to go this way. And we make contingencies that, well, okay, if this doesn't happen, I've got to do this. Or we worry about something that may never happen. And do you see how distracted we become? Here is Joseph, an ordinary man, an unusual man, in that he was just common. And God had something special in store for him. God was going to use him. But yet now, in the midst of his doubts, he's devising a plan. Now, can I just stop right here for a minute? And not just talk about Joseph's plans in the midst of his doubts, but maybe talk about what we do and our plans. Joseph's change of heart and plans start out like a lot of ours. They begin with wrong assumptions. Hello? Joseph hears his wife is expecting. His assumptions, his doubts begin to run, mock speed. He goes and begins to build his plans on these false conclusions. You know, when we do that, really and truly what we're doing is we're making our foundation for our life very weak. And to me, it's frightening to see that someone as righteous as Joseph was not exempt from this. And it makes me step back and say, "Whoa, wait a minute, if Joseph can have doubts and he wasn't exempt, then, well, none of us are." So what do? When we start with doubts, where do we go? How do we move forward? What can be done? Not a good place to start, but yet I told you it's a progression. We're going to go from there to step number two. Step number two is what we call trust. Now, anytime we face doubts, we have choices. Two in particular, as we see here in Joseph's life. Number one, we can make a rash decision. We can say, okay, everything's falling apart. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do it right now. That's a rash decision. Can I just tell you the statistics show that that usually doesn't work out very well? You know what I mean? Ever been guilty? Man, I sure have. I think, man, if this isn't going to work, then, hey, we got to do something. We got to go here. Well, that's one choice. The second choice is we can trust. We can trust in the Lord. And do you know that trust is the complete opposite of skepticism? Because remember I told you skepticism is when we doubt the truth. We question whether or not it's valid, but yet trust is a firm belief in the truth. Joseph's going to wake up and come to his senses. He's going to see that the doubts that I had, even though they may have been common, even though many people would have said, hey, they're built on a firm assumption, he sees that they are totally wrong. When the angel appears to him and speaks of the things, the angel basically says to Joseph, and I'm saying to you this morning, the things that we think are impossible, think again. They are possible with God. Do you think Joseph just wanted to look at the angel and say, it can't be, that's impossible? But God, with God, all things are possible. So the angel speaks to him. He begins to tell him what is about to happen. Now you talk about blowing Joseph's misconceptions and plans out of the water, but yet it leaves him facing a decision. He can choose to give in to his doubts, go with his plans, or he can take a step back and say, okay, God, my trust is in you. Can I just tell you there are times when we put our trust in the Lord and we start moving forward, we're going to hear a lot of voices saying, what are you thinking? You think that's going to work? You think you can do that? Seriously? You believe that? You really and truly think those people calling you are caring about your car warranty? I just wanted to see how many of you were awake, all right? I was just testing you there. Just wanted to make sure you hadn't left me. But you know, Joseph is faced with that decision. What does he do? Does he trust or not? You know, on a side note, when assurance comes to us when we listen to the Lord, assurance will be ours when we stop doing things our way and do it God's way. When we stop blaming others because things aren't working out as we think they should and start looking at ourselves and at God. Here's the third step. When assurance comes, it should be followed with obedience. You know, we started out with doubt. God has given us an assurance. What do we do? Joseph started with doubt. The angel gives him assurance. He is obedient. He is obedient. Didn't care what others were going to think. He was focused on what God had in store. If, when faced with doubt, we put our trust and confidence in the Lord, He's not only going to give us an assurance, He's going to give us peace. Remember that scripture we heard this morning? Prince of Peace. God is going to give us the peace inside of our heart that no matter what others are going to think and others are going to say, we're walking with God. We're faced with a choice. Our choice is, will we be obedient? Will we change these self-assured, sometimes arrogant attitudes of our own in order to be humble and obedient and open to God's plan? Can we accept the fact that God works in unusual ways even today and sometimes uses, well, unusual people, unlikely individuals like us to be able to accomplish and achieve great things? I can't help but believe today that some of you here are struggling with doubt, maybe doubting yourself, maybe doubting that others care, maybe doubting that God has something in store for you. And those doubts are pulling you down. You're thinking right now of the decisions that you've made, of what you're going to do, your plan, and maybe you sense the Holy Spirit saying, no, if you will just listen, if you will just trust, if you will just follow me. Today, we're all faced with a choice. We can harbor those doubts, and we can be defeated. Or we can let our faith and trust take hold of God's great assurance. And then we can make that bold choice to follow God no matter what. We may never make the impact on the world that Joseph made. But have you ever studied the life of Joseph? There's not a whole lot there. But yet, he's got a figure right here with the little nativity scene. He's a part of God's plan. Could it be that God was saying to us through someone like Joseph, see, you may not be up front, but God has a plan. Will you be obedient or will you go down in a heap of doubt and destruction? So where are we? What do we do? Where do we go from here? Would you let me pray for us? Jesus, we need your help. We've looked at this progression of assurance, of how, well, it starts where some of us may be today, in a sense, in a spirit of doubt, discouragement, despair, always seem to go hand in hand with this. And there are some here today that are on the verge of defeat because of all of this stuff. Today, Jesus, as we look at this unlikely individual, a carpenter named Joseph, as we see how you used him as an integral part of your plan to bring your gospel of salvation to unlikely people such as us. Today, Lord, would you help us to bring our doubts to you? Would you help us lay aside our struggles and focus on you and allow you to work your plan in us? Would you bring us encouragement, Lord, today? And would you help us, because of all that you do, to be obedient to you. Today, that obedience may come in the form of just praying and saying, here I am, Lord, show me what you need. That obedience may come in the form of, I'm going to stop right now, get on my knees and pray and seek the face of God. That obedience may be to get up from where I am and go out into the world around me and share the life-changing word of Christ. Today, Lord, would you help us to make that decision that we are going to go all the way with you, no matter what. Give us that strength that we need, that courage that we need, that encouragement that we need to be what you've created us to be. We love you today, Jesus. And we ask these things and pray these things in your mighty holy name. Amen.
Teenage girl, much too young, unprepared for what's to come. A baby changes everything. Not a ring on her hand, all her dreams and all her plans. A baby changes everything. Changes everything. The man she loves, she's never touched. How will she keep his trust? A baby changes everything. A baby changes everything.
Lost, but now I'm found.
changes everything. A baby changes everything.